Let's take a look now at images from across the country. What has India's response been on the demand for a lockdown? The second day, actually, yesterday was more a request. Today it was supposed to be serious, and it's supposed to go on now for several days. As you can see in several parts, and many of these images are from Delhi, people are out, were out on the roads. Some people were out jogging as if life was absolutely normal. In other places, people were assembling in large numbers. The fact of the matter is that this message has just not gone through. People were violating the rules as if it's some sort of a holiday. It's not a sort of a holiday. Social distancing is going to save lives if it is followed. It just has to be done. This is for the lives of the people you love, for those around you as well. It is critical that this is done. Several state governments have made it clear that if these rules are not followed, then you are in deep trouble tomorrow onwards.
Deserted streets as the national capital went into lockdown, and only those who provide essential services like food suppliers, government servants, healthcare professionals and media persons being allowed. With only 25% DTC buses on the roads and no metro or autos, even those who are involved in essential services struggled.
मैं संजूर मेडिकल में काम करता हूँ. ओखला फेस वन में हमारा ऑफिस है. हमको अब करीबन एक मिनिमम एक घंटा हो गया है. अभी बस ही कोई नहीं है यहाँ पे, तो अभी हम लोग वेट कर रहे हैं उसका.
अंचल प्लाजे साहब पेट्रोल पंप का काम करते हैं, आधा घंटे से ऊपर तो हो गया खड़े हुए.
At border points like the Gurgaon border and Karnal bypass also, there was strict checking, and many who could not establish that they were going for essential services were turned back, leading to huge traffic jams in the morning.
मैं गुड़गांव से आया हूं. एक्चुअली क्या कुछ का जाने नहीं दे रहे, मैं इनको रिक्वेस्ट कर रहा हूं, कह रहे आप रूट पकड़ लो.
Hundreds of laborers belonging to UP and Bihar are now stuck in Delhi, waiting at the Anand Vihar bus terminal for interstate buses which are not plying.
Train sahi abhi ek train ho raha hai, wo aayega 2 baje aayega idhar. अभी ये देखो, अभी 6 बस इधर से चला गया, पूरा आदमी उसमें भर के गया. अभी कितना आदमी है, अभी एक ट्रेन और आएगा 2 बजे, वो किधर जाएगा आदमी.
मालवीय नगर काम करता हूँ, मेरा 35 परिवार से हम यहाँ भाई से हैं, और मेरा घर में मेरा दादा इंतकाल कर गया, मुझे जाना जरूरी है. ट्रेन भी नहीं चल रही है जो हम जा सकते हैं, और टिकट भी नहीं बन रहा है, और ट्रेन रद्द कर रहा है, मुझे कोई चाहिए गाड़ी.
Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal later admitted that 25% DTC buses were too less and that the government was expanding it to 50%.
कल हमने इसको 25% कर दिया था बसों को, हम ये बढ़ा रहे हैं. कल से 50% बसें चलेंगे. अगर लॉकडाउन का पालन नहीं हुआ तो सरकार को सख्ती करनी पड़ेगी आपके साथ.
While the lockdown was a much needed measure in order to prevent further spread of coronavirus, blanket bans without proper transport provisions for needy cases are going to hurt the underprivileged the most. In New Delhi with camera person Ashok Mahale, this is Sukirti Dwivedi for NDTV.
Well, Mumbai has announced more measures to fight the COVID-19 pandemic, including the sealing of districts to stop the spread of the coronavirus.
काल आपण एक निर्णय घेतला होता की महाराष्ट्र राज्याच्या सीमा या आपण सील केल्या, म्हणजे इतर राज्यातून आणि इतर राज्यात होणारी जी काही ट्रेन सेवा असेल, बस सेवा असेल, इतर जी काही वाहतूक असेल, फक्त जीवनावश्यक वस्तू यातून अर्थातच वगळले गेलेले आहेत, पण त्या वाहतुकीवरती आपण बंधनं आणली. आज आपण आंतरजिल्हा म्हणजे जिल्ह्या जिल्ह्याच्या सीमा सुद्धा सील करतो आहोत.
महाराष्ट्र चीफ मिनिस्टर गेट्स टफर अनाउन्सिंग न्यू मेजर्स टू स्टॉप द स्प्रेड ऑफ द कोरोना व्हायरस. Mumbai is already under a strict lockdown. No trains at Dadar in the morning, no trains at Churchgate, no couples on Marine Drive, the usually crowded Chowpatty deserted. A near complete lockdown, but there are irresponsible citizens too. Police had to make announcements to ask people to stay indoors.
Unbelievable scenes at Dadar station. Usually at this time in the morning, this place would be chock-a-block with passengers. Passengers getting off trains and boarding trains to get to work. As part of the lockdown, local trains have been completely withdrawn from service, which means there are no trains running.
At Churchgate station, a similar eerie silence, not a soul on the platform.
We're at the Churchgate station. The scenes of a lockdown quite clear. Not a single soul on the platform completely empty, and this is perhaps how it should be in a lockdown. But not everywhere do you get to see these scenes.
At the domestic terminal of the Mumbai airport, a completely different story. Passengers with emergencies queuing up to buy tickets and fly out. They have time to do so till midnight on Tuesday, when domestic flights will also be grounded.
The Mumbai police enforcing the restrictions announced by the Prime Minister and the restrictions announced by the Chief Minister. They're enforcing those restrictions, but it's not an easy job as there are violators on the street. And this is perhaps what is the problem. People violating the restrictions as the police try and enforce it on the ground. And this is what needs to change. In Mumbai, with camera person Sanjay Mandal, Saurabh Gupta, NDTV.
Satyendra ji, thank you very much for joining us. Are you disappointed at people in Delhi today? There were so many people who came out. There were crowds in some areas. So what is your message to people in Delhi?
देखिएगा मेरे लोगों से हाथ जोड़ के विनती है कि ये जो लॉकडाउन किया गया है ये एक बहुत मजबूरी में और बहुत जरूरी की वजह से किया गया है. आपको समझने की जरूरत है कि जितना लोग वन टू वन कॉन्टैक्ट करेंगे उससे वायरस के फैलने को मौका मिलेगा. जो कोरोना वायरस है, कोविड 19 जो बीमारी है, ये एक इंसान के दूसरे इंसान के कॉन्टैक्ट में आने से फैलती है. अगर हम इसको लोग घरों में रहें, आपस में कम मिलेंगे, तो ये चेन टूट जाएगी. और ये चेन टूट जाएगी तो हम बच सकते हैं. आपको समझने की ज़रूरत है कि आज से एक महीना पहले, डेढ़ महीना पहले, इटली में, फ्रांस में, स्पेन में, लंदन में और ये जर्मनी में एक एक दो दो केस होते थे रोज. तो वहाँ पर भी चिंता नहीं की किसी ने, उनको लगा कि कुछ नहीं है. आज देखिएगा एक दिन में एक देश में 5,000 केस हो रहे हैं. इटली में 5,000 से ज़्यादा केस एक दिन में हो रहे हैं. एक दिन में 500 डेथ हो रही हैं. अगर आज हम इसको सीरियसली नहीं लेंगे तो हमें बहुत बड़ी बुरी तरह से भुगतना पड़ेगा. ज़्यादातर लोगों को ऐसा लग रहा है, उनको ऐसा लगता है कि भाई हमारे यहाँ नहीं होगा, आई एम सेफ, मुझे नहीं होगा, किसी और को होगा. हर आदमी को लगता है कि जैसे आग लगी हो ना तो कहते हैं मेरे घर में नहीं लगी कि पड़ोसी के लगी है. अरे पड़ोसी के लगी है तो आपका नंबर भी आएगा अगर आप इस टाइम सतर्क नहीं होंगे. सबको इसको सीरियसली ले लेने की जरूरत है. बहुत ही मजबूरी है. अगर बहुत ही ज़्यादा मजबूरी, आप घर का कोई सामान लेने जाना है, सब्जी लेने जाना है या दूध लेने जाना है, वो भी कोशिश करके दिन में एक ही बार जाइएगा, घर से बिल्कुल ना निकलिएगा. सरकार ने कितनी मजबूरी में कितने सारे कदम उठाए हैं, उनको अगर आप फेल करेंगे तो मुझे लगा सारा सिस्टम फेल हो जाएगा.
सत्येंद्र जी, कल से पुलिस कार्रवाई शुरू होगी, इस बारे में क्या बताएंगे आप?
देखिएगा आज काफ़ी सारे लोगों को कन्फ्यूजन था. मुझे बताया गया कि दिल्ली के बॉर्डर्स पे काफ़ी लोग थे, उनको अंदाजा नहीं था कि भाई प्राइवेट ऑफिस बंद हैं, प्राइवेट शॉपिंग मॉल्स वगैरह सब कुछ पहले से बंद थे. लोगों ने होलसेल मार्केट खुलेंगी, प्राइवेट ऑफिस खुलेंगे, तो लोग उनमें नौकरी करने वाले आ रहे थे. आज सबको पता लग गया कि दिल्ली के अंदर सभी तरह के ऑफिस बंद है एक्सेप्ट एसेंशियल सर्विसेज. एसेंशियल सर्विसेज बहुत थोड़ी सी हैं, जैसे हेल्थ सर्विसेज हो गई, बिजली, पानी, इस तरह की सर्विसेज हैं. अब लोगों को क्लियर हो गया है कि एसेंशियल सर्विसेज प्रोवाइड करने वालों के अलावा सड़क पे कोई आ नहीं सकता है. तो कल से मुझे लगता है लोग भी बाहर नहीं निकलेंगे और कल से सख्ती भी की जाएगी. और मैं लोगों को बता देना चाहता हूं, अगर जानबूझ के लोग इसको उल्लंघन करेंगे तो उनके खिलाफ FIR भी हो सकती है, अरेस्ट भी किया जा सकता है.
और पुलिस डिप्लॉयमेंट ज्यादा होगा कल से?
बिल्कुल, पुलिस से बात हुई है, वो कह रहे हैं कि डिप्लॉयमेंट भी ज्यादा होगा. आज मैंने बताया ना कुछ जगह कन्फ्यूजन था, परंतु बहुत सारे एरियाज में बिल्कुल इसकी कंप्लायंस अच्छी भी थी. कुछ एरियाज के अंदर, आउटर एरियाज के अंदर, जहां पर बॉर्डर के आसपास के एरियाज में थोड़ा सा कंप्लायंस कहीं जगह थोड़ा कम थी, जिसको कल से और पुलिस बल लगाकर और अपने हम SDMs वगैरह को भी लगा के इसको थोड़ा सख्ती से पालन कराएंगे.
और DTC बस सर्विसेज के बारे में बताएंगे?
देखिए DTC बस सर्विस में क्या हुआ कि हमने बसेज इसलिए चलाई थी एसेंशियल स्टाफ के लिए, और वो 25% बसेज हमने चलाई थी. वो काफ़ी नाकाफी रही, क्योंकि एसेंशियल सर्विसेज में डिस्कॉम्स में लोग काम करते हैं, बिजली कंपनियों में काम करते हैं, पानी की कंपनियों में काम करते हैं, सारी हेल्थ सर्विसेज हैं, प्राइवेट में, गवर्नमेंट में हेल्थ सर्विसेज हैं. तो जो बस थी, क्योंकि हमने ऑटो बंद कर दिए, टैक्सी बंद कर दी, मेट्रो बंद कर दी, तो 25% बसेज काफ़ी कम पड़ गई. कल से हम 50% बसेज कर रहे हैं, सो दैट के एसेंशियल सर्विसेज देने वाले लोग आराम से जा सके, बसों में भीड़ ना हो जाए.
जी,
ऐसी भी शिकायत आई है कि बस क्योंकि कम थी, बहुत ही कम थी, अब बस में ही भीड़ हो गई, तो इसलिए हम कल से आज के मुकाबले दुगनी बसें चलाएंगे.
और आप इस बारे में तो जरूर खुश होंगे कि एयर ट्रैवल जो है कल से बंद होगा, डोमेस्टिक एयर फ्लाइट्स भी बंद होंगे. आप कल अरविंद जी बता रहे थे कि होने वाला है, आज जो है सरकार ने घोषणा की है कि कल से बंद,
कल से पूरे देश का एयर ट्रैवल बंद हो रहा है. मुझे लगता है ये हार्श स्टेप है, इनको होना ही चाहिए. देखिएगा जितना भी वन टू वन कॉन्टैक्ट कम होगा तो वायरस को पनपने का मौका नहीं मिला, फैलने का मौका नहीं मिला, अलग अलग टेरिटरीज नहीं मिलेंगी. तो अगर एक बार हमने इसको रोक लिया, स्प्रेड को रोक लिया, तो मुझे लगता है ये चेन रिएक्शन से हम बच जाएंगे.
Absolutely clear messages. Number one, social distancing. Social distancing, social distancing, social distancing. Number two, stay at home. Number three, follow the government. Number four, if you break the rules, you might be punished. Number five, leave your home to go to the shop only if it is required. Otherwise, stay at home. This is not just for your life or the lives of the people you love. It's for the lives of people all over our city. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us with those details.
Thank you.
Well, joining us now are Derek O'Brien, Rajya Sabha MP of the Trinamool Congress. Thanks, Derek, very much for being with us. There's been one very sad loss of a life in Kolkata today, in West Bengal today. And there appears to be a fair amount of confusion about this individual because some believe that this individual didn't travel or come in touch with anybody who did. Is there any clarity on just what this is? Was this a case of community transmission?
I'm not going to sit here and make any expert comments sitting here from Delhi. So we shall wait for the message from the Health Department of Bengal before there's enough all kinds of information floating around across the country. So I don't want to add to that. Let me not say something unless I know all the details.
No, but that said, are you worried about community transmission in Bengal? Without necessarily speaking about this one case, I understand your point. Are you worried about the spread on the community transmission thing?
Well, it's not a question of being worried about it in Bengal. It's something we need to worry about all India. And I can only share with you that because we were worried about it all India, in Bengal and all India, that's why the Mamata Banerjee government there took some very serious measures. That's why Mamata Banerjee wrote to the railway minister to say, shut down the railways, which was done. That's why Mamata Banerjee wrote to the aviation minister and said immediately shut down the airways. And we are glad it is done. It's done from tomorrow, but her suggestion has been accepted. We would have been happier if it was done from tonight. That having been said, there are 6 or 7 good practices in Bengal. This is not the time to do any politics. I have a lot of criticism of this government. I will reserve that for later, not today. Not today. The first thing, 7.5 crore people in Bengal, the poorest of the poor, Mamata Banerjee has taken care of them. How? Their rations till September, done, it's free. That's 7.5 crore people. The next group of people are the health workers, the doctors and the health workers, the nurses. They are putting themselves under huge risk. Announced some while ago, there's a 5 crore extra insurance coverage for them. Another thing, the rest of the country, I'd appeal to the other chief ministers to emulate a cancer hospital which wasn't inaugurated, 300 bed, that's been turned into a isolation center. This football stadium, part of that football stadium has become a quarantine center. Very, very good state of the art, with about 150 beds there. And Calcutta Medical College is being the hospital, 400-500 beds. That's perhaps going to be India's first only totally dedicated to the coronavirus. I think there are two or three other things, Vishnu, if I may just add. The communication from the chief minister is direct and it's every day. And I would like to use this because if the communication is rational, it is compassionate and it's decisive. The three words are important. It has to be rational for the Lord's sake. You can't be making emotional appeal now. This is a national health emergency. Okay, these are very, very important. Now, there was a unique thing which happened today in Calcutta to all opposition parties under the leadership of the Chief Minister. They had a meeting and guess what? That meeting was telecast. I wish more states do this. It gives everybody a sense of confidence. Ventilators, obviously there's shortage everywhere. We've got 70 out of the 300. And of course, ICDS, we're using that network to get across our time.
Derek, what was the compliance today in Kolkata?
You see, the compliance is very, very good. It could obviously been better. You have to understand, this is a top down. You know, first, we were the most compliant. In fact, that is why, because of Mohammadi's direction, we've been going blue in the face, saying, give the right messaging. Why was Parliament running today till 6:45 in the evening? What messages are you giving? There was no Trinamool MP there. We've been trying to explain, but I don't want to use this as a blame game. The messaging has to be clear.
So what is the message for people in Kolkata tomorrow? Will there be police action against those who don't follow the rules?
You see, there are police. This has to be a partnership. This has to be a partnership. You know, this has to be a partnership between good communication, which will convince people. We're not running a police state. As long as we communicate very, very well, if we keep communicating from the top, as I said, rational, compassionate, decisive, it's very, very important to communicate like this. You know, the chief minister is directly talking. There's a whole, you know, there's people in Bengal, like the chief minister of Kerala, I think, doing a good job. Bengal people are trusting Didi because right. they know
so
she
Derek,
is...
So, Derek, I take your point, and I think let's focus and hope that things remain in a situation where people follow the instructions and, you know, things get better for all of us. I'd like to thank you very much for sharing that perspective of what's happening in West Bengal. And you know, and let's hope that, you know, things remain that way, and hopefully there's greater compliance. I'm sure we'd all hope
see,
for that to take
place. At the end of it all,
yeah.
At the end of it all, I think there's a whole system in place. For example, in West Bengal, more than any other state in the country, we have the highest number of hospital beds. We have some 75,000 hospital beds. The rest of the country is much less than that. So there have been a lot of proactive measures. And I'm glad today that many of the measures taken by Captain Fantastic Mahmoudadi in Bengal, at least some of the other states will follow, and the central government, at least on this rail lockdown.
Right. So let's look at this also, I think, Derek, in as much as you speak about Bengal, and I appreciate that, let's also look at it from a national standpoint and hope that other things that other states replicate a lot of this. Thanks very much for being with us. Let's also quickly take a look at a couple of graphics before we move on to our big panelists. We've got some excellent researchers from around the world. What exactly is the World Health Organization saying? Well, the WHO is saying a lockdown is not enough. Countries cannot lock down societies to defeat the coronavirus. There is a need to isolate those with sick due to the virus, and their contacts need strong public health measures to avoid the resurgence of the virus. The disease may jump back up after lockdowns are lifted. Let's move on now to our next set of graphics. Let's take a look at some common symptoms over here. Now, this is very important. Let's bring that graphic up of the symptoms. These are the top symptoms which actually come in, which may indicate that you have COVID-19. Firstly, a severe dry cough is something which is a matter of concern. Keep changing the points. A fever of approximately 100 degrees Fahrenheit, so not necessarily very high, but a shortness of breath, another key concern which a lot of people feel, but also a sore throat, aches, a runny nose, tiredness, and nasal congestion. These are all virus warning symptoms of the coronavirus. Let's also take a look at the growth rate, the rate at which the virus tends to, the number of people who contract the virus actually tend to double within a very finite number of days. So what we'll try and do over here is actually bring you a couple of numbers. But first, a look at the China situation. China grew fast from its 100th case to its 10,000th in just 10 days. So the numbers over there in China, and remember, China is now recovering, were overwhelming. Let's compare that with the situation in India. We have gone 100th case is on the 15th of March, so 100 to 415 cases approximately in a period of 8 days. But that rise is very significant. If not the overall numbers, the rate at which it's going up seems to replicate what's been taking place in other countries. And I'll tell you why that's the case. Let's bring up the next set of graphics if we can. What we are trying to do now is actually look at separate countries. So let's bring up the graphics and take a look at Italy and the rate at which it's been doubling. Now, on the 17th of March, the rate in Italy, the number of infections in Italy was at 2,158. On the 22nd of March, that went up to 4,827. So 2.2 times was the rise over there in a finite number of days. Now, again, the growth scenario in Spain on the 19th of March was at 598. That rose substantially to 1,326. That's 2.2 times in 2 days. Let's move to the next set of graphics. 724 in Iran went up to 1,556. These were the death toll, as it were, in these countries. So again, a significant rise in a period of 6 days. And finally, let's take a look at the India numbers, if we can. These are the numbers of cases in India. It's gone up from 137 to 320. That's 2.3 times in 4 days. So the number of cases that we see over here in India, and a few of the other cases were actually of the death rate. But the point is that there is a steady rise, and in a finite period of time, there is a more than doubling of the rate. Well, let's just go across now to our panelists. I'm joined by Debashree Roy, the Department of Epidemiology and Biostatistics at Johns Hopkins University. Giridhar Babu, the Professor of Head Life Course at Epidemiology at PFI in Bengaluru. And Dr. Sameer Dalwai, the National Joint Secretary of the Indian Academy of Pediatricians. Thank you all very much for being with us. Debashree, let me come to you first. Is that perhaps the biggest point, that the number of cases goes up and doubles in a very finite period of time, that it's not slow, the number of the growth rate, in fact, it's incredibly fast? Is that the biggest worry?
Yes. So as we've seen in many other countries, you know, the number of cases initially increase very, you know, gradually. But then, you know, just suddenly there is an explosion in the number of cases that you observe. So, you know, that is indeed a big worry. It depends, of course, on a number of other factors. For example, the more you test, the more you will identify these undetected cases that's there in the population. And that's why I think WHO is really emphasizing on, you know, increasing the number of tests being conducted.
Okay. Dr. Dalwai, when you have a situation like we saw in many parts of India today, when citizens just did not heed the call to stay indoors, what are we potentially putting ourselves at a risk for from a number standpoint? How could this go over the top?
Well, we have to understand that most of us will get infected. It's a new virus. We don't have any immunity against it. We will get infected. But the great news is that the overwhelming majority of us will develop immunity to it and will not suffer much from the virus. It's just like any other common cold infection, a virus. What is important to remember is those who are at the extremes in terms of very poor immunity, senior citizens who have got diabetes or who are on anti-cancer or immunosuppressant medications, they will be the 1% who will develop some complications that require some hospitalization. Now the point about social distancing is this. If we do not have social distancing, one person or few people get together on a particular day, on one day you may get 100 people getting infected. 14 days down the line, these 100 who have got infected, one of them will land up in hospital like we said. But instead of 100 getting infected on one day, if 1,000 get infected, 10 people will land up in the hospital on the same day. If 10,000 get infected on one day, you have 100 people who land up in the hospital. Now the point to note is all those 100 are potentially salvageable or savable patients. They require only mild treatment, maybe oxygenation, some would require ventilator. But the point is, if you have 100 patients who walk in on one day and you have only services enough for 10, what happens to the remaining 90? And that is exactly what is happening in Italy and Spain, that suddenly the cases have, you know, exploded so much that there is a huge strain on the health system. Those who could have been salvaged are not being salvaged. Now, how does social distancing help? You mentioned the number of cases. These are the diagnosed cases. Be sure there are thousands who are not diagnosed but are still infected. And we don't realize the symptoms for 14 days. So if you say that you have 400 diagnosed cases today, you can very surely assume there are many, many more who are undiagnosed.
Yep.
While they don't have symptoms, when they go around mingling with everybody, they give rise to this explosive increase in numbers, which you will realize 14 days from now. And hence, this lockdown is very essential so that I do not spread the infection to many people if I have it for the next 14 days till my own body develops immunity to it, and then I don't infect others. What we will do by that is we will make sure that only 10 patients get infected a day, maybe only one lands up at the hospital, 100 get infected, one lands up at the hospital. Next month, another 10 get infected, 100 get infected, one land up at the hospital. If we have lesser number of people coming because of this pandemic to the hospital, we can take care of all of them.
Okay.
So the idea is to see that the infection doesn't spread exponentially in a day.
Okay. I just want to go across to my other panelists, Dr. Dalwai, as well, so that I just need to rotate the strike quickly. I'll come back to you in just a moment. I want to go back to, Professor Babu as well. And what, sir, is at this juncture your biggest concern in terms of the numbers itself? Do you see the number situation in India potentially getting out of control? And I ask this because there are some who believe that despite the lockdown which the government is calling for, we may already potentially be in a stage when that may not be enough, that the situation could actually become much worse despite the lockdown.
Vishnu, we need to understand two concepts here in order to understand why the numbers are like this. The first concept is called, in terms of containment. What is containment? You identify all the people who have the disease and then isolate them, and all the contacts who are in coming in touch with them, you quarantine them. This is called containment. The next concept is called mitigation. Mitigation is delaying the spread of the virus transmission in the community. Now, for any country to succeed in terms of reducing the numbers, it's important to do both of these measures, which is containment and mitigation. The later you start these measures, higher will the number of cases. So let's begin in terms of understanding what a curve is. So in terms of an epidemic curve, initially you will see very few cases. Later on, as the other panelists said, it will start multiplying and then it will exponentially increase. We have the wisdom of learning from the mistakes of all the other countries, and these measures that we have taken in this country are unprecedented. So in my words, China has biggest weapon in terms of mandatorily restricting. In terms of South Korea, it was testing. But in this country, we have the Prime Minister who made this appeal to everybody. Everybody was thinking India will never be able to do this kind of a measure. Through one day, voluntarily, on volition, people trying to be in the house, not going out, we have proved that we can definitely do mitigation.
Yeah, but we failed on day
two. Then how do we do containment?
But we failed terribly on day two.
This is dependent on...
We failed terribly, Professor Babu, on day two. Today, it was terrible. In Delhi, you've had the Chief Minister come on record and say that, look, tomorrow there's going to be police action. Right, so that number situation is...
I'm unable to listen to the question, Vishnu.
Yeah, we'll come back to you in just a moment from now. We'll fix that line. I want to go across to Parikshit Ghosh, Associate Professor at the Delhi School of Economics. Parikshit, there are all sorts of numbers which are doing the rounds. Some of these numbers indicate that we could be up to lakhs of cases in a very finite period of time. Thousands of deaths in a finite period of time. But how does one actually compute these numbers, particularly since there are variables? The biggest variable now is the introduction of a lockdown. So how does one actually calculate these numbers and potentially how bad it might get from here onwards? Parikshit, go ahead. Okay, we don't have Parikshit at the moment with us. Let me go across to Dr. Ravindra Mehta as well. Sir, I don't know if you'd like to take that question, but how is it, do you sometimes have question marks on these numbers? Because a lot of the numbers are incredibly frightening numbers, that they could be over the top. Do you believe that it could potentially be as bad as some make it out to be? Dr. Mehta?
Yeah. Yeah, so these are all projected numbers coming from experience from other parts of the world and basically fine-tuned by this category of people called epidemiologists. And their job is to put a number in just like a finance guys do, what's going to happen and so on. So this is what's coming out there, and the issue is often they will paint the worst case scenario because healthcare and governments have to prepare for that. Yesterday, New York declares 40 to 80% of New York is going to get affected. You can imagine the numbers. A similar 50% is touted for India. So you can imagine 1.25 billion, what are we talking about? So once you paint the worst case scenario, that's when you basically start getting worried. It's based on a simple thing, the infectivity of the virus, the huge amount of people are there, the person-to-person spread. Imagine a disease where the human you're trying to save is the same human who's spreading the disease. You're putting in social distancing, but we don't know it works on the ground. We don't have a single survey telling us that what is the effectivity of social distancing. My high school daughter did a survey of 4,500 middle class and higher class people, who 15% of which don't believe it's going to work. So 1 in 6 doesn't believe it's going to work. So if these guys are going to be the weak link in the chain, which is going to determine the spread of disease, where do we stand? And so that's the challenge. Each part of management is lovely theoretically, but on the ground, it's like a relay. You take one part, you take social distancing, lockdown. It's going to work only so much. The escapes are going to prepare. We have to prepare for the next level. Next level is these guys are going to hit healthcare. We don't know how. It's not like a defined thing that you can put a radar or something. These guys are going to hit healthcare anytime. And for the first time in a century, they're going to hit in a way we don't know. They're going to be infective. We don't know they're going to be which area. And if they hit an unprepared healthcare system, they're going to not only cripple it, but spread it. And we're going to be in a mess which Italy and China have seen. And we don't have all the resources to contain it. So okay. This is one sort of a thing where this picture has been painted so that you understand effectivity of X measure is only so much. This gives you time. Social distancing lockdown gives you time, buys you time. It's not a panacea. Where it will break down, you can see all the discussions. Buses crowded, it's breaking down. People going nuts, it's breaking down. They're not going to think of corona. They're thinking, how am I going to reach my house? I'm panicky out here. Then will come the fact these guys are going to reach healthcare, and that's what we're worried about.
Soldiers okay, sir, just give me a moment. I just want to get a few more perspectives in on this as well. Rupam Bhattacharya, the Department of Biostatistics at the University of Michigan, with us as well. Rupam, the numbers that are being forecast are incredibly frightening. Obviously, there is data on the basis of Italy, Iran, and of course China. But there is also the variable now that the lockdowns in India have started. So going forward, what are some of the realistic projections that we can have in India? Yes, we are doubling within a couple of days the rate of infections, but there is also a lockdown now. But how bad can this be in a finite period of time?
Right. So the first thing I think that is important here is to understand every country in terms of their healthcare has a limit, right? That can be a limit in terms of the number of doctors or nurses who are available to aid the people, or that can be in terms of the number of beds that you have in your hospitals and stuff like that. So the first thing, the talk that all is going about flattening the curve and all, the main target there is to make sure that not too many people get infected at the same time. So the study that our group, the COVID-19 study group that conducted it with researchers from the University of Michigan School of Public Health and also other centers, some of whom we'll be talking soon. What we saw is that in the absence of any intervention from the governmental level, the numbers are going to be really high and they are going to cross the number of average hospital beds available to people in India within, say, 1 month or so. And even if you do like a basic level of travel lockdown, like only international travel lockdown or something like that, our projections essentially estimate that in the long run, you are going to cross that line at some point. So the only way we can really have a hope of getting through this and giving the aid to every people who actually are in need of it, who get affected by the virus, is by flattening out the curve, by imposing more strict measures. Mm-hmm. And those numbers, the projections that we did under those scenarios, assuming very harsh lockdowns, very high levels of social quarantining and all, those numbers actually are pretty hopeful. They show a surge in the long range anyway, but in the shorter range, I believe they will be more under control. And that, I think, should be the primary focus now. Let us more focus on the fact that within May end or June beginning, we should be trying to curb this to a level where it is at least controllable by the hospital beds and the number of doctors and nurses in India. We should not be running out on resources. That's the most important part.
Yeah, and I take that point completely. I think that's perhaps the most important point. We need to control it to what we have available in terms of healthcare. Dr. Sushila Kataria is the director and head of internal medicine at the Medicity in Medanta and has personally looked after a number of patients who have contracted the COVID virus. These were Italian nationals who transferred to Medanta. I think, doctor, in all of this, as we look at numbers and frightening numbers and the availability of ventilators and the importance of testing and all of that and lockdown, we tend to forget one very important aspect, that most people actually recover from this. And therefore, what is your message, doctor, to people out there who may actually contract this and are worried, not knowing what can happen next?
Well, to all those people who already have COVID infection, my point to them is that you would recover. There is a good chance, 95% chance you would recover. There is an 80% chance you would recover without much help. But
yeah, go
I
ahead.
Want to say
yeah.
that some patients will get really, some patients would really get sick. And in that case, you would need intensive care treatment and some special treatments. So for that, we are ready, we are geared up. But it's good that if you do not get it, all those people, I was listening to all the panelists and I saw some, you know, pictures today, what has happened during the lockdown. Prevention is better than cure. I look at these patients day in and out. I see the sick patients, they keep asking us whether I would survive or not. Definitely, I would request to all my countrymen that I do not want to see you in that position. So please take care, take a good care of yourself. This is just a 2 to 3 weeks time. This is a make and break situation for all of us in the country. Either we fail or we pass with good situation. So please do not let anybody fail. Do not let the country fail. This is my humblest opinion, that observe social distancing, observe self-isolation. Nothing would happen if you will not party for 14 days. Nothing would happen if you will not go to the market for 14 days. Nothing would happen if you will not go to a spa. So you would survive, you will stay good, stay healthy. And, you know, prevention is the key to control the spike of this epidemic. Otherwise, we will be left with the choice. As the panelist said, there will be 10 patients needing ventilators and I have only 5 ventilators. Please do not put me in that situation where I have to choose whom to give, whom not to.
Yeah, no, I think those are so important. Thank you so much, Doctor, for mentioning all of that. I'd like to thank all my panelists in this segment for sharing all of those details with us. I need to take a short break to come back with a little bit more and focus on those who are trying to make a real difference by trying to make ventilators here in India, which may be necessary. Stay tuned. What makes the COVID-19 virus so deadly? Why is it so contagious? How far away are we from a cure? Joining us now, one of the world's foremost researchers on novel coronaviruses. Professor John Nichols is clinical professor in pathology at the University of Hong Kong. He was a key member of the research team at the University of Hong Kong, which isolated and characterized the novel SARS coronavirus, which was associated with the global outbreak of 2003. He's been published widely in Lancet, Nature Medicine, and several other leading research journals, and is significantly looking at viral binding sites in the respiratory tract. Now, this is critical in the context of COVID-19 and its potential impact on the respiratory tract of patients. Thank you, Professor, very much for being with us. A simple question which a lot of people have is, where are we in terms of medication to deal with this? For example, it's been suggested that that chloroquine-based drugs could be effective at this stage. A cocktail therapy of HIV-related drugs in some cases might have proved to be effective. Before we get to the vaccine stage, how effective is this medication in dealing with this virus?
Well, as you've indicated, we're nowhere near getting a vaccine. So right now, most of the standard antivirals, which have been used for the other virus, don't actually work. So we're left with trying to deal with other types of agents. So the anti-HIV has shown a bit of effect. And so there are a number of clinical trials which are going on around the world, especially in Hong Kong right now. But that's very expensive. There's a limited number of these compounds available. So as you pointed out, there's a lot of attention to this combination therapy, and that's based on the report which came out from France, which said that chloroquine, together with a specific type of antibiotic, did seem to have some effect. Now, unfortunately, it's had some adverse news publicity, that people have been buying lots and lots and lots of the chloroquine. There's been cases of chloroquine poisoning. However, to look at this is that my understanding is that in New York is that they're actually going to try a combination therapy. This is, but one of the interesting things is that not only just these antibiotics, is that the reason how they may have an effect is not through the antibiotic effect, because we know it's a virus and not a bacteria, but their anti-inflammatory mechanism. Because one of the things which we found looking at both the H5N1 and the SARS is that it's the severe inflammation in the lungs which causes the damage. So this is a wait and see to see whether or not this combination therapy is of any benefit.
Professor, social distancing is seen to be, a key preventive over here. But then there are those who suggest that there is only so much that social distancing can actually achieve, particularly if you enter the stage of community transmission. I don't know if you've been following the situation in India closely, but once it does enter the community, as it certainly did in the case of Wuhan and other parts of China, is social distancing good enough?
Well, I think what has been shown is that China, especially Wuhan, are showing that the medical treatment decreased the death rate, but it was actually the social mechanisms which actually brought down the number of overall infections. And so that was a combination of both quarantining as well as attention to the surfaces, and also now there's far more interest on this social distancing. This is because there's a bit of interest in basically how this virus is spread. Is it through the direct contact, or is it through the aerosols or the fomites? And the more of the evidence, some people say it's more the aerosols and also the fomites, which is why the social distancing is becoming more common. Reason being is that, as probably happened in India and other places, there's a shortage of masks. And so there's a limit to the number of masks that people can also wear. But I think also what we found is that the great attention to keeping a clean surface, the clean hands, these two mechanisms are going to be extremely effective. Adherence to
the bands has not been as effective as many governments would like, which means it needs to take more draconian measures.
Social distance. So in Germany now, only two people can actually be next to one another. I think you have to force these mechanisms to keep the number of infections down, because to keep them down will decrease the number of severe infections and thus the overload on the healthcare system. So whilst it might seem very severe, I think it is necessary.
Professor, the types of tests are available. There are certain tests which have been devised which give a result on a quick time basis. There are other tests which actually need a significant period of time to get a positive or a negative result. Is this a fundamental problem as we look at this from a global level, that there is no uniform series of tests which are quickly available, and therefore there is no uniformity in test results coming out?
Okay, so this is where the Koreans were very, very effective and in doing